Hi, so this is going to be a course showing you how to use human UI. And what it is a really cool solution to a problem that's increasingly common in offices where Grasshopper and parametric design in general is becoming an increasingly important part of the workflow. So, for example, here's a very, very simple script where we generate a form, we modify different aspects of this form, it generates a building volume, and then the second part splits it up into floors according to a set of given floor heights and a number of floors for each floor height. So that gives you some information to work with. The heights for each floor, the total height of the building. We can get the areas for the floors and so on. So this is just a very simple massing exercise. However, it's quite easy to do this from within the Grasshopper interface. But the problem comes when lots of professionals want to be involved in this form finding process. So what does this mean? Say you're in a presentation with, say you're in a workshop with several of your colleagues, or maybe even a client, and this requires going back and forth into the Grasshopper interface, looking at the results, analyzing the data that comes out. And then at this point, the Grasshopper interface itself ceases to be the most ideal way of interacting with this model. Since the last thing you ever want to be doing in any sort of a workshop or presentation is fiddle around with wires when nobody really gets what you're doing. And that's almost even unthinkable when you're presenting to a client. So what human UI is a way of very neatly designing an alternative interface to the Grasshopper workspace, where you show only what you want to show for the purposes of whatever exploration you're doing, and you have pretty great control over the graphics and quality of this presentation. So you can simplify everything, and you might not even need the typical Rhino viewports open, because it can integrate 3D graphics into the window. So as parametric design becomes more involved in the design process, more people have to offer their input and be able to interact with your model, and you basically need a way to do this properly. So the very first thing that we're going to do is look at what's in the tab. So let's just expand this. Now you've got a tab with containers, a tab with elements, a tab with graphs and charts, a tab with the main components, and a tab that's used to modify each of those components once they're in the window. So before we start making sense of all of these, let's just do the very, very main function of these components, which is to launch a window. Now, you do that from this main tab, and you have the option of launching a normal window or a transparent window. So let's just try them both. So the only thing that you need to launch a window is either of these components, again, opaque or transparent, and a Boolean toggle, which tells it to launch. So if I just click on, suddenly I've got a window. Now this gives you an option of making this a child of Grasshopper or a child of Rhino. So what this means is that if you select child of Grasshopper, as soon as you minimize Grasshopper, the window is going to be minimized too. However, if you click child of Rhino or always on top, then you can minimize Grasshopper, and it's going to be overlaid onto your workspace in Rhino. And so the idea is that we should never have our Grasshopper window on, and we want to very precisely curate what information we are presenting in this window. And even, as I mentioned, do away with Rhino altogether and just look at information on this window. So now, actually, you want to click always on top so we can see it here. Now, what this gives you are several options. And this is going to be the case for most elements in the human UI. Each individual element is going to give you options for the graphical display of this type. So, for example, the first one allows you to change the name that's displayed on this window. See? So you change it to My Interface. You can also change the starting width and the starting height. Now, you can open it and resize it however you want once it's open, but you may want to alter how large it is once it's open. So you can set that to whatever works for your screen. And essentially, that's created your window. And again, we can plug all of these into this other window, which is transparent and whatever works for you guys graphically in terms of the aesthetic that you're going for. Each of these work equally well. And so you have the window component. The next crucial component is this one, again, from the main tab. It's called Add Elements. And what you do is you select the window that you want to add the elements to, and then you plug any UI elements that you've created into this box, and they'll be added to the window. So it's as easy as that. So for example, let's look through the Elements tab and find something very simple to create. So for example, we can create a basic label. Let's just open this window again. And the label just basically takes text, takes label size, and justification. So it's very, very simple. Not all of them are this simple. So you plug this into the Elements tab, and suddenly it's there, and it shows up. So what else can we add? We can add, for example, sliders. So how this works is you can add any slider element to here. You can tell it to round to any given value, but we don't really want to, and that would be created here. And that is actually labeled according to what the slider is labeled. Sometimes you have to refresh the whole window once you're adding stuff. So I think what you actually have to do is create a new one and then add it. And then the name is going to be on there. So that's just a small little glitch, but it's easy enough to get around. So what you've noticed is that the order in which we add the elements is the order in which they're going to be displayed from top to bottom. So I can make several of these sliders. Add them all. And you can see the order in which I plug them into this add elements component is going to be the order that they're displayed here. So now the labels on there last. But that's essentially how this works. Now, the interesting thing is that you can see, for example, that the window is going to be reflecting whatever's happening to the sliders or whatever component it's linked up to in Grasshopper, the window is going to be reflecting it. However, once I move these, this one isn't being updated. So this one isn't being changed from here, from my new interface. So what we're going to have to do is implement the correct feedback mechanism, and that's what we're going to look at later on in another video, because the whole idea here is that this isn't just an output window, this is also an input window where you can change the entire Grasshopper definition through this interface and never even have to open this window. So we're going to divide this into kind of input elements and output elements. Now, these are input elements. Let's look at, for example, an output element. Let's just disconnect all of these. Let's go back to the tabs. And say, for example, we want to take this series of numbers, which are the numbers of floors and the floor heights, and create a chart with them. So actually, these are still on, so you might have to kind of refresh the window every so often. Right. So if I just get this chart, which is basically a UI element, but it's also helping you manage data. So it's got its own section. You can create a chart, you can create sets of charts, and then you can modify anything you want about their appearance. So let's just look at this one quickly so we can understand how this works. Let's create another one of these, which I deleted, and say, and connect this here as an element. So what this wants is the list of values to be charted, which would be this one, and the names of the data items. So let's say the floor heights are the data item names that we want. So there it's created. And you could do things like change the title of the chart. Create a subtitle. And here it's asking you for the type of chart to create. So you have various options. Now, say for example, actually want the labels to be not the floor height, but the type of program in the building that corresponds to that floor height. So say 6 meters is commercial, office, residential, And there you go. Whenever this changes, it's reflected back to here. So suddenly there's 16 commercial floors and the graph is updated. Now this is basically how this component functions in the sense of creating outputs. What we're going to do next is first look at how to manage inputs, outputs, and finally create a set of custom diagrams. So, but basically this is the gist of it.